Hello and welcome back everyone to French Bread's Dark Souls 3 Lore Run. My name is French Bread, or Chris if you prefer. And you know we had to do the Praise the Sun emote at least once in this playthrough, right? It would be sacrilege not to. And plus, don't we look like we love the sun? This is clearly the attire of a sun worshipper. But, enough, enough poor humor. We want to get straight to taking on the next boss, I think, in this episode. I did do a very brief amount of farming. I got that scholar's robe I was talking about previously, and we'll read that after we defeat the boss, after we have a chance to have a little bit more to work with in our item roundup. And I thought about it in terms of whether or not I was going to summon allies to join me in this boss fight. And I thought about it and damn it. This gives me time to tell you about how I had thought about whether or not I wanted to use allies, because I'm pretty dang sure that allies are just going to make my fight against Prince Lothric more difficult than it needs to be. But in the end, I've decided to go ahead and do so, if only because it's going to give us an opportunity to fully appreciate the boss's moveset, maybe see some of his less common or more interesting moves. And if we die, we die, no big deal. I'll simply come back and crush him solo. And we're going to, if possible, if at all possible, summon both Orbeck and the second NPC that I happen to know is in the area. I'll let these big bad knights move on by, and I'm going to open this cool looking door first. Just so that I can hopefully make sure Orbeck doesn't go chasing after enemies down below. Orbeck of Vinheim, though never really of Vinheim, I feel. Aha! We can summon her. May as well. This is what she signed on for. And we have a hella boss fight waiting for us. This room couldn't be anything else, right? We can see Lothric up there, and can definitely tell he's got the robes of prayer on. I don't know where we got our robes from. Perhaps they were his old robes before he grew out of them. Anyway, let's enjoy the cutscene here.
Oh dear, another dogged contender. Welcome, unkindled one, purloiner of cinders. Mind you, the mantle of Lord interests me none. The fire-linking curse, the legacy of Lords, let it all fade into nothing. You've done quite enough. Now have your rest.
So, Lothric is bringing his big brother to the battle. you can tell that Lorerun seems to... Oh, there's a rare attack right away. Lorerun seems to not have full use of his legs here. Though he does have full use. Whoop. Zerus is in trouble. Of a big-ass sword. And every time he teleports around... Oh, you know what? I think Orbeck just cast Pestilent Mercury. That's cool. But I think every time Lorerun teleports around, that's actually Lothric's magic assisting him. This fight's so lame with allies. You know what? I'm not even gonna help. I don't even want to win this way. Let us simply observe. Sorry, Orbeck. Sorry, Cirrus. I know we could have done it together. Ooh. A little bit of Excalibur action. I believe in you, Orbeck. After all, you did so well against me. Let's reset the stage here. Hopefully that gave you a good indication of what Lorerun is capable of, but I just couldn't bring myself to play it that way. Doing the party gank on the boss. Let's do this properly, as much as we appreciate our good nights. Lorerun's definitely no weakling, but oops. Unless you're getting too greedy like I am. It's not super hard to dodge. If you had a weapon that did more damage than this, you'd be having an even easier time of it. Greedy, but we got a stagger, so our greed was rewarded. Using a lot of stamina here. Like I said, greed. What is he? Oh! Is there something above us just now? Huh. Oh, flying carpet.
Dear brother, I'm on my way. My brother, unyielding sword of Lothric's prince. Rise if you would, for that is our curse.
Very, very unique boss. Ow, ow.
This
shit
marks our grave. But you may rest here too, if you like.
Alright. Once again, I will see you on the flip side. See if we can't do this properly this time. I got a little too... played a little bit too risky with that much health. We should have known better. Try and get our rhythm here. Kinda helps, I think, with the Excalibur attack, as I'm going to call it, to lock onto him and then kinda dodge diagonally and to the side in order to avoid it, because it does have a decently wide hitbox, even though it's a lion attack. Let's get our stamina back. Look for the next opening. Ow. Oh, that was a... There we go. Smarter. Put a... Oh! Fuck. I don't know if that's gonna show up on the video, but my game just locked up for a second. Alright. Up here, stupid magic. Ah, shit. Alright, let's try and regain control of the situation. You can tell Lothric's sword is really, or Lorerun's sword is really getting angry now. He'll cast these golden soul spears at us. Ooh, I almost mistimed that. So in this phase, you can see that the only way to really do damage to Lothric is to attack him from behind Lorerun, and they both take damage. And there is a mechanic where Lothric is gonna revive Lorerun. He dies. But there's really no reason not to do it, because it gives you just a few extra hits on him before he does a little Wrath of God-esque attack. So, it's just some free hits. No reason for you not to take advantage of it. Ooh, nice hold. Or delay, I should say. I always call it a hold attack, even though it's clearly a delay attack. Let's not be too greedy, too sure of ourselves. Even though I'm pretty damn sure of myself.
Mark my words, Ash One. You remain among the accursed.
And there we go. Cinders of a Lord and Soul of the Twin Princes. We made out all right for ourselves. One retreat. I guess you called a retreat. I could have, with those two on my side, I actually could have easily defeated them in that first attempt, but didn't feel fun, didn't feel right, so I couldn't help myself but to try again. What are these on the floor? I'm not easily distracted. Are these feathers? Is the floor covered in feathers? Huh. Now, that gets me thinking. These are feathers. Does that mean Lothric had some connection with the angelic faith? Or were adherents of the angelic faith coming here to kill or hound him, and this is all that's left of them after encountering Lorerun there? God, I don't know. You guys will have to give me your own opinions on that, because I'm not entirely sure what to make of it. But we got stuff. So before we head back to the shrine bonfire, let's check out the Soul of the Twin Princes. Let's see. The two princes rejected their duty to become Lords of Cinder and settled down far, far away to watch the fire fade from a distance. A curse makes their souls nearly inseparable. Settled down far, far away. I don't think it means... excuse me. I don't think it means like miles and miles and miles away, you know, like hundreds of miles. I don't think they like fled to the other side of the world or anything. I think they just situated themselves far away from it locally, because I do believe the first flame is located at least somewhere in the vicinity of Lothric. Perhaps not. Perhaps the first flame is still where it's always been, in Lordran, around the Firelink Shrine of that area, and possibly our area, who's to say? We've already established that the locality and reality of Firelink Shrine is highly suspect. Cinders of a Lord left by Prince Lothric. If the lords themselves will not return to their thrones, let them return as cinders. The Lothric bloodline was obsessed with creating a worthy heir, and when this proved impossible, resorted to unspeakable means. Suffice it to say, the path to linking the fire is a cursed one indeed. I wonder if they didn't consort a little with the dark. I wonder if they didn't consort a little with the angels. The government ostensibly may have condemned the angelic faith, but what if the royal family, in desperation, made some kind of pact with them? But it obviously went wrong to some extent, because Lothric was cursed and frail, and Lorerun soon followed him, as we will see once we check on some of the transposing items.
Aha, thou returned, and a fine day it is. So, the eyes show a place. So, what is...
Okay. Let's see, the first thing we can get is Lothric's Holy Sword. Prince Lothric's Straight Sword, blessed by Emma with potent magic. Young Lothric was meant to be a champion, and was expected to wield this platinum sword, but some things will remain distant dreams forever. And the ability is Sacred Lothric Light. Assume stance to imbue sword with sacred light, and use strong attack to release light together with a great thrust of the sword. I think that's the Excalibur-style attack that Lorerun was using against us. I believe he was basically being granted that ability through his inseparable bond with his brother. We also have access to Lorerun's Greatsword. Ultra Greatsword of Lorerun, Prince Lothric's older brother. Cast in smoldering molten steel and stained black. Before Lorerun embraced his brother's curse, he was a knight who single-handedly slayed the demon prince, but the victory eternally scorched his sword with flame. And its ability is Flame of Lorerun. Lunge forward to transform, smolder into flame, and follow with a strong attack to launch flame across the ground.
Treat.
So Lorerun initially was every bit the warrior he seemed to be, but with no handicap. But his companionship with his brother led him to assume the curse, or assume partial burden of the curse, and I guess caused the deterioration of his legs. And now that we've bested them, we have access to Lorerun's armor set. Lorerun's Helm. Armor of Prince Lothric's older brother Lorerun. This black-dyed brass helm is patterned with flame. Lorerun, raised as a knight, is said to have been left mute and crippled by his brother's curse. It is also said that Lorerun, in fact, wished it so. Interesting that he was left mute. We also know that through her interaction with the angels, Gertrude was left both blind and mute. With this crown covering his eyes, Lorerun may as well have been blind as well. I think... Yeah, the armor is no different except that it indicates it was passed down to him from the royal family, which, you know, fair enough, makes sense. Now, you might have also noticed that we have access to the Sunless armor set, which is the armor set of Cirrus. Sunless Veil, attire of a knight from the Sunless Realms, known for their resistance to both magic and the dark, formed of a silk veil and a silver headband. Sunless nights serve the nameless moon, and perhaps it is for this reason the attire casts a feminine silhouette. Let's buy this too. So yeah, no surprise there. They pattern themselves basically after Gwyndolin, which is why the armor has that, and you know, the moon. But that was also kind of part of the Gwyndolin package, but that's why they appear, the armor appears to have a somewhat feminine look to it. Most unfortunately, however, the reason we have access to this armor is because Cirrus, I guess, believing that she had fulfilled her duty as a knight, and strictly speaking she has, now that we have Lorien's ashes, we can proceed to the linking of the fire, but I guess with that duty done, she's allowed herself to die. Which, by the way, I guess that means that she was human. Which, if that's the case, maybe I'm wrong, but if that's the case, makes Cirrus a bit more of a badass. Even so, not happy. Not happy to see her this way. All the good characters perish in the end, don't they? Yo, keep watch of this spot, buddy. It's important. Don't let anybody mess around with it. Well, shit. We've lost another ally. Seems like we're destined to hold nothing left in our hands once this is all said and done. And speaking of lost allies, I have been told that we will find another in the Grand Archives. I'm not sure where though, so bear with me as we do a little bit of a search. If the search takes too long, I'll fast forward, but hopefully that won't be the case. Nothing there. Let's go the normal route. And I'm sure, quite sure you guys can guess who I might be referring to here. There's no need, I suppose, to be coy, really. We're on the hunt for the final resting place of Orbeck. Which reminds me, we do need to read these scholars' robes when we get a chance. Orbeck, Orbeck, are you here? Not there. Maybe he's at the waytop, where the top location where there's all those cursed. I don't like this. I don't want this. Let's try to just run past, because I don't really feel like fighting these assholes. I was gonna say maybe he's up here. Hopefully they won't chase that far. Oh. Yep. Let's clear this trash out of our way. What good did you scholars ever end up doing? Hiding away here in your archives? there. Ah! Okay. Fine. That's what you want. That's what you'll get. Buddy, you missed your last chance. Dick. Alright. Here, in the center of the Grand Archives, Orbeck's body is seen. Hollowed, no less. I wonder what led him... I mean, I understand what led him to arrive here, but it almost appears as if he was allowed to be here? I don't see how else he'd become all cozy and nestled in this chair. So was it something he discovered which caused him to hollow and give up? Or did he figure there was nothing left to learn and he just wanted to let go and give up in a setting he found most pleasing? Pretend one last time that he was a real sorcerer. Let's check out those robes and let's check out Orbeck's ashes. Umbral ash of Orbeck of Vinheim. Orbeck was fascinated with sorcery, but without means, so offered to serve as an assassin in exchange for acceptance into the Dragon Academy, believing that one day he could reinvent himself as a sorcerer. I don't know. I feel like in the end, perhaps thanks to our intervention or our assistance, he was able to become a sorcerer to some degree. I don't think anybody else could have deciphered those scrolls as efficiently as he did.
Ah, well, well, what warm, umbral ash have we here? It's as if thy fate were with death entwined. But take no note of me. Thy business is thine own. As by now thou surely knowest, there is little I love more than a gratuity of souls.
Yo, shrine handmaid. Did you absorb the soul of Nito or something? Because you're reminding me quite a bit of a Grim Reaper right now. Anyway. We get all of Orbeck's spells. Should we have missed any? And we also gain access to his coat. Clandestine coat. Traditional coat of the Vinheim Dragon School. Normally a deep blue color, this black variation is a sign of a sorcerer engaged in surreptitious work. These were covert agents who excelled at manipulating sound. And I have to comment that this does appear to have a different appearance for a female. Because we saw what it looks like on a dude. But the chicks get a different version, which is, hey, that's kind of cool. Not going to complain.
Ashen one.
Let's see how it looks, actually. Because I am curious. Yeah, just back out. That's not too bad. That's not too bad at all. I like it. If only there were time. Time for more fashion. We'll see. We'll see. I gotta think about what I want to do next in terms of fashion. What the heck did I have on? I had Morn stuff. There we go. Now, whoops, sorry. Now, next Now that, well, Cirrus is no longer here to object, let's go and initiate an event that we held off on so very long ago. Let's indulge Leonard and converse with Rosaria of the Deep. Equip the emblem to demonstrate our loyalty. Right here we have a curious little maggot person who, by the way, is technically aggro to us because we can't use the bonfire anymore, which means we have only one option. So I told you guys we'd eventually meet Hazel in person. Not really the way I would have liked to have done it, though. Yet another NPC I would have loved to have been able to talk with. But no such luck. Too many rebirths is my best guess. That if you accept rebirth too frequently, you are transformed into something base and grotesque. Looks like we'll have to do a little bit more than just show up. Fair enough. Yo, Rosaria. Let me offer this pale tongue to you. Officially establish ourselves as one of her fingers. Ah, and that's all it took. Back here, old ring finger's shown up. Man, you better not. That's what I thought.
Ah, so you've chosen to serve Rosaria after all. She will be pleased with me for finding her another finger. But be warned, my friend. Rosaria's fingers need only fetch tongues for their mistress. Otherwise, we are free, unchained. Like Yellowfinger, you can choose to believe that all fingers share camaraderie. But do not force your romance upon the rest of us.
So, Hazel believes she was part of a troop of comrades. Perhaps after the Abyss Watchers linked the fire and her home of Farron was turned into a rotten swamp, she sought answers, a reason for what happened. And when she discovered Rosaria, she thought maybe she found a new home, a new family. Fortunately, things were not really as she believed they were, and her final fate was pitiful indeed.
Rosaria's fingers need only fetch tongues for their mistress. Otherwise, we are free. You are free to believe that all fingers share camaraderie, but do not force your romance upon the rest of us.
That's all he has to say for the moment. But let's reload this area. Ringfinger is gone. And what the hell? what did he do to Rosaria? Black eye orb. Ah, crap. This is a familiar situation. Black eye orb. Arcane orb left on Rosaria's corpse. Have faith her soul can be retrieved by invading the world of her killer and returning victorious. The black eye is proof of vengeance, but often appears serene as it casts its gaze towards Irithel. And you know, I didn't really notice before now, probably because when I first played Souls, I'd never picked up or read any Berserk, but these things actually look like the doohickey that can summon demons in that world. I don't know what it's called, but it looks a lot like those. And given how much we know Miyazaki and FromSoft dig on Berserk, well, it's no surprise, is it? Let's track down this would-be killer in a scenario that is familiar but not entirely the same as what Lothric did in Dark Souls 1. He killed the Firekeeper of Firelink Shrine, which also left a black eye orb, and we invaded here in Anna Orlando in the hallway before the boss room in order to retrieve her soul and bring her back to life. In this case, it seems as if the NPC is not as crucial as the Firekeeper was, but still, not cool, man. Let's see what Ringfinger has to say for himself.
Well, well, never expected to see you here. Felt sorry for the poor thing in all her festering glory. And now you want to ravage her soul as well. I sow the seeds, I'll prune the mess. I, Leonard, swear so upon my vows to the goddess.
Leonard here has sorcerous arts at his command. And a shotel-like weapon. Big surprise, right? Hey, Leonard, guess what? I know. Oh, shit! I know you're a fairly smart cookie. He's gonna try to get the kill, but I'm not gonna give it. Ooh. Damn. Leonard ain't no joke.
No one will despoil her soul. Certainly no beast wrapped in human skin.
Yo, that ain't fair, man. I ain't no beast. Chug away, my friend.
What do you want with her soul? Isn't flesh enough for a sick beast?
Yo, I'm not comfortable with this bloodborne looking guy talking about beasts. Ow. You got limitless FP, my friend? What justice do you have, too? Ah, you're all out, my friend. Ow.
blessed Rosaria.
Soul of Rosaria, Crescent Moon Sword, and Silver Mask. Guys, that is going to do it for us this time. Next time, we're going to dig into these final bits of available lore on Rosaria. A little bit about what exactly was going through crazy old Ringfinger's head. And then we're going to proceed to the next area in the game. I hope you enjoyed the episode. Hope you'll join me again. All that good stuff. Take it easy.